stand.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
We welcome you today to St. John the 23rd Parish as we celebrate the 22nd Sunday of Ordinary Time. As we hear all of these readings today and we gather in around this altar, as we hear in our opening hymn, it's all about being a doer of the Word. It's easy to hear, it's easy to listen, but it's another thing to do God's word in our lives, meaning live that love in your families, in your relationships, in all that you do. Do it for the kingdom of God. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of God's kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
We glorify you. We
Let us pray. God of might, giver of every good gift, put into our hearts the love of your name, so that by deepening our sense of reverence, you may nurture in us what is good, and by your watchful care, keep safe what you have nurtured, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said to the people, "Now, Israel, hear the statutes and decrees which I am teaching you to observe, that you may live and may enter in and take possession of the land which the Lord, the God of your fathers, is giving you. In your observance of the commandments of the Lord your God, which I enjoin upon you, you shall not add to what I command you, nor subtract from it. Observe them carefully, for thus will you give evidence of your wisdom and intelligence to the nations, who will hear of all these statutes and say, 'This great nation is truly a wise and intelligent people.' For what great nation is there that has God so close to it as the Lord our God is to us whenever we call upon him? Or what great nation has statutes and decrees that are as just as his whole law, which I am setting before you today?" The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter of St. James. Dearest brothers and sisters, all good giving and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no alteration or shadow caused by change. He willed to give us birth by the word of truth, that we may be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Humbly, Welcome the word that has been planted in you and is able to save your souls. Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deluding yourselves. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
With
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. When the Pharisees with some scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, they observed that some of his disciples ate their meals with unclean, that is, unwashed hands. For the Pharisees, and in fact all Jews, do not eat without carefully washing their hands, keeping the tradition of the elders. And in coming from the marketplace, they do not eat without purifying themselves. And there are many other things that they have traditionally observed: the purification of cups and jugs and kettles and beds. So the Pharisees and scribes questioned him, "Why do your disciples not follow the tradition of the elders, but instead eat a meal with unclean hands?" He responded, "Well, did Isaiah prophesy about you hypocrites? As it is written, this people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines human precepts. You disregard God's commandment, but cling to human tradition." He summoned the crowd again and said to them, "Hear me, all of you, and understand. Nothing that enters one from outside can defile that person, but the things that come out from within, they can defile. From within people, from their hearts, come evil thoughts, unchastity, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, licentiousness, envy, blasphemy, arrogance, folly. All these evils come from within, and they defile." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. I mentioned a few months ago in a homily that I think there's two things all of us as human beings really desire. And the first is to be loved. I mean, everybody wants to be loved. Who doesn't, right? We all want that. And we also want to be understood, that when we say something, people actually understand what we're saying, they meet us. So our readings today focus on those two aspects, about love and understanding, and probably more on the understanding part. Because just as human beings, all of us, want to be loved and understood, Jesus does too. Our Lord does too. He wants that when he speaks to us, that, you know what, we're listening to him. And we're changing ourselves to him. So there's a couple aspects of what we hear in our readings today, all of them. And that's sort of the difference between hearing and listening. All you need is a sense of hearing that you can hear. And, you know, and I know it's a very critical sense because it allows us to hear people speak to us. And sometimes hearing can be very difficult. But hearing is hearing the word. It's another thing to listen to someone. Because when you listen to them, you absorb it. I've been reading a book by Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who the night before her wedding, she was told by her mother-in-law to be a little deaf in her marriage, meaning that she might hear her husband Marty when he would speak, but perhaps maybe not really listen to it and let it just roll off of her shoulders. And it was designed really to keep a harmony in marriage, because people can, they can upset us, right, if we listen to them too much. But there's a completely different thing about hearing and listening. So our first reading speaks of Moses telling the people, hear the commandments of the Lord, hear them, hear them. And what Jesus is saying in the gospel is, listen to me. Take it in, and I want your whole self. I don't want you just to hear words coming out of my mouth, but I want you to take them in, absorb them, and then let that be your lifestyle. There's a word that goes hand in hand with listening. And what that word really is attention. Because when we pay attention to someone, that phrase that we use so regularly, it means we're listening to them. And we're hearing the word, and we're allowing it to resonate within us. So we would say to people that a lot of moms and dads, they attend to their families, right? We know people that attend to their jobs. But the root of the word attention means to stretch oneself and to absorb it and make it become part of your meaning. So a mother or a father attentively working with their family and with their kids, or when we're attentive in our relationships and our friendships and so forth, what we're doing is we're starting to stretch ourselves and allowing, as they speak to us, we not only hear them, but we're listening with our whole being and allowing that. That's what God is asking from all of us. Because just as we want to be loved and understood, that's what our loving Lord wants us to do, to be his people. So we hear today in our gospel, we have these scribes and Pharisees. They would be considered a very educated class that has studied God's teachings, studied the commandments. Today it opens up that they come from Jerusalem, so they're coming from this high holy place. And they come and they meet Jesus' 12 apostles, you know, he meets them. And they find that, you know, they're saying what they're doing is they're not following the rules. They're not offering a love because they're not ritually purifying themselves. And so what they're basically saying is they're not living the real Jewish way, not living the right way. And Jesus looks at them and speaks to them, and what he's basically saying is, you're not listening to me at all. And what he says in our gospel is that we want to listen from our heart. And so in today's world, we would look at the heart as not only the organ in our body that moves blood around, but we also think of somebody who, you know, does something with heart. We think of it from almost a romantic way or an emotional way, I love you type of way. But in the old days, at the time of Jesus, when we did something with our heart, we did it with our mindset. We did it with our whole being. So phrases that we know today of putting your heart into it, or I give it my whole heart, or maybe when someone's lukewarm, you might say, geez, you don't have any heart for this type of thing. And what they're referring to is our old ways over the years, that when we give our heart, we give our whole being. And what Jesus is saying to these scribes and Pharisees, as well as to the world, to all of us, he wants us to put our heart and our soul into our faith life, to not only listen to him, but to also understand and make changes in our lives. And when we give our whole heart, we give our heart in a way that allows us to be his chosen people and attend to the things. So just as I explained about moms and dads that work in their families and they attend to their families, what they're doing is they're putting their whole heart into it. We know people that are passionate about their jobs, about their sports, about gardening, all sorts of things. And when you're passionate about it, you're passionate in a way that it orders your whole life to protect that particular trade or relationship. And in this case, Jesus is speaking of the relationship. So Moses may want people to hear the word and so forth. What Jesus is saying, I want your whole self. I want you to put your heart into the matter. I want you to put your attention into the matter. And I want you to stretch yourselves so that you are faithful. So the example that's given in our gospel is putting foods in your mouth. And we can relate to that. And I brought today with me a Cheez-It box that I'll squeeze out of here. So basically, we live in a world that we follow the labels, don't we? And we follow the labels about what we put in our mouth. And we will hear, you are what you eat. So when I growing up, if I ate junk, you will be junk. We've all heard that expression. My parents handed it down to me. But we are what we eat. So the Food and Drug Administration and the Department of Agriculture, they set out this label that tells us that we're supposed to put 27 crackers of these into a dish. Not 28, not 26 to get a single serving size. And I asked yesterday at the 4 o'clock mass, does anyone really do that? I just fill a bowl, hopefully a small bowl, you know, like that, right? But we do have one taker that actually will do that. But when we do, they'll say you have 140 calories. Now we know that whatever we put in our mouth, we are what we eat. But what a difference if we compare these Cheez-Its to our Eucharist. When we come here and we receive our Lord, what a difference. This will come and go. In a couple of hours, I need either another drink to go with it, or I need another meal, right? More likely, I'm back there in the kitchen. When we receive our Lord in the Eucharist, we place something in our mouth that gives us food for the journey, our daily bread. And what Jesus is saying, become what you eat. He's not saying become like a Cheez-It, but instead become more like him. So he would agree that what we are what we eat. But instead of worrying about calories and so forth that we have to do, I mean, that's part of respecting our bodies and taking care of our bodies. What Jesus says is this is what you need to consume. You need to consume the gifts of the Holy Spirit. You need to consume God's wisdom, God's counsel, God's fortitude, a spirit or a fear of the Lord or a wonder or an awe, a way of knowing that understanding all of those gifts of the Holy Spirit. That's what we consume because we are what we eat. And the more that we attend to our faith lives, it will have a multiplying effect on our relationships, well beyond the food that's judged by the Department of Agriculture. In reality, God gives us the saving food to do God's work. And you'll find in our gospel that it speaks of what comes out of the heart is what can defile a person. It goes through a laundry list of all these temptations and so forth. But what our Lord wants us to come out of our heart, if we put our whole being into it, he wants us to come out with the fruits of the Holy Spirit. So the fruits of the Holy Spirit that come out of our mouth is really a love, a joy, a peace, a faithfulness, a goodness, a gentleness, a self-control. That's what should come out of our bodies if we are listening attentively to him. And if he is loved and he's also understood, like all of us. So in your own life, if you think about it, sometimes it's hard to love. Sometimes you don't want to love. And I think we all know that when we don't love, it defiles our body. It hurts us. But when we offer that love, even when we don't want to offer that love, what we're doing is we're listening to the Word of God. We're changing ourselves. We're putting our whole heart into it. And we will yield a bountiful harvest in our families and our relationships. When we exude from ourselves a spirit of joy or a spirit of peace, or a spirit of faithfulness, or a spirit of gentleness. That's the beauty of God's work at hand. And I think we all know that sometimes all of these different things, joy, peace, and love, all of these, gentleness, all of them, they require a decision that I'm going to love no matter what, I'm going to be joyful no matter what, I'm going to be peaceful no matter what. It's actually a sense of self-control. But when we do those things, we are listening to the Word of God, we're hearing the Word of God, but we are living the life, a life of a true disciple. And when we do too, God's promise to all of us is that He will be with us. So all throughout the scriptures, we will hear words like, love as I love you. If you follow my commandments, your joy will be complete. All of these fruits of the Spirit we hear right from this reading, because what we want to do is order our lives that we don't defile anything and hurt ourselves. And instead, we grow ever stronger. Yesterday, I had the grace of marrying a couple. I had them on their sign. The couple would be on our sign all weekend long. But in reality, these are two little lovebirds that got married yesterday, you know? And they love each other very, very deeply. It's very obvious through all of my meetings with them and so forth. But the love that they have is a love that we want to grow every day of their married life. And anyone who's married or knows someone who's been married knows it requires a lot of work and a lot of self-control and a lot of making sure that we order our lives with a faithfulness. So my prayer to them was that they order their life, partnering that life with God at the center of their marriage. And the gospel that they chose spoke of when love exists, their joy will be there. In reality, when we listen, we will not only understand, but we will order our lives. So today, as we begin the day, think about your own families, your own relationships, all of those things. And what Jesus calls us to do is to have a sense of self-control, to make sure that what comes out of ourselves is love, is joy, is peace, is faithfulness, is kindness, is self-control. Because when we do that, we will yield a bountiful harvest. It's not what we put into our mouth this way, it's what we put into our mouth that way. And that's the bread that leads to the next world, to eternal life. So today, let's be attentive to our families and build up that kingdom of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. I invite you to rise as we now renew our baptismal promises using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. As children of God, we bring our cares to our loving Father as we're called to be doers of the word and not hearers only. For Pope Francis and all the faithful throughout the world, for all of us, may God give us a spirit of wisdom in our decisions and actions and give us the strength to offer self-control in our daily circumstances. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the salvation of the world, may the Lord grant mercy and all who have turned away from him, bring them out of darkness into light, and may we be faithful participants in his word every day. We pray to the Lord. For all who are struggling with poor health or mental anguish or addiction, we pray in a special way for our parish sick list, all those in need of our prayers. We pray for all the ways in which we're broken or grieving, that the Lord may offer us that healing touch and may give us words to inspire us. We pray to the Lord. For our faith community of St. John the 23rd, may the Lord help us to embrace those things that endure forever and are not fleeting. We pray to the Lord.
Hear our prayer.
For those who have died, Friday night, I had a chapel service for Mario Siriani. I pray for him up in Kenmore. Also pray for Pat Gerard, a longtime parishioner of our parish that died Friday evening. And for our Mass intentions today, we pray for Helen Schneller and also Joe Krug. I learned from Don all about Helen. She passed away right before I arrived here, and I had the joy of knowing Joe Krug, and I was just talking to Sheridan, our picnic, about what a wonderful family that the Krugs had built. So we pray today for Helen and also for Joe, and also may we meet them again. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for those prayers that we voice now in the silence of our hearts. We make these prayers through the intercession of St. Joseph. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father, we entrust our prayers to you in the holy name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all, his holy church. May this sacred offering, O Lord, confer on us always the blessing of salvation, that what it celebrates in mystery, it may accomplish in power through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for through his paschal mystery accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end, we acclaim.
Blessing.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with this Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope, and Michael our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you after passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom we bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
With your spirit.
In our own indirect way, let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Renewed by this bread from the heavenly table, we beseech you, Lord, that being the food of charity, it may confirm our hearts and stir us to serve you and our neighbor through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Today at this Mass is Toni Lesser. She just celebrated her 60th wedding anniversary during the week. Let's give her a round of applause. We wish many, many more happy years for herself and also for George, and blessings upon the whole Lesser family. You'll see in the back of the church, or the front of church, we have our ticket booth for our chicken barbecue. As we're almost at September 1st, it's about 3 weeks away. So if you could pre-register for it, sign up for it, I'd be grateful. It helps us on pre-sale ticketing, helps us know where we're at, you know, like that. So you'll see also in the bulletin a flyer for the Chosen series, which is our fall programming. This is a phenomenal series. It's copyright, I think, 2019, so it's brand new. I don't think there's anything more current than this going through the nation. And you'll see at the bottom that it has on the reviews a 9.6 stars out of 10 stars. The Internet Movie Database gave it a 9.6 as well. And Rotten Tomatoes gave it 96%. So it really is just a phenomenal series. And it's about being chosen. So I really loved our communion hymn today. Here I am, Lord. That's what our whole message of these readings are all about. About hearing the Lord and also listening to him. So that comes really from 1 Samuel, where Samuel says, here I am, Lord, your servant is listening. Jesus will, when he's baptized, the heavens open up and God the Father says, listen to my beloved son. Jesus will say that whoever has ears ought to listen. And also the good shepherd, the sheep listen to my voice and they follow me. That's what the Chosen is all about, hearing it from different perspectives. So there's 8 sessions in it. It's a video series with some discussion afterwards in a group setting, but it's not a lot of reading. It's really about, you know, immersing yourselves in the scripture. So put this on your fridge, encourage your family and friends to join. It's 7 Monday nights and 1 Tuesday. You will love it. And virtually 100% of the viewing population that has seen this since 2019 has given it just a phenomenal review. So you really will enjoy it. It's gonna take place in our arcade hall, but consider it's important right now as we move into the fall to really try and stay close together, especially through this pandemic and all everything, you know. But our programming here has always been top notch, but that's our fall programming. You'll also see there's another thing on the 14th of September calling being holy. It's tips to just increase and build your own prayer life. Another great thing. So please, if you can, sign up for the chicken barbecue. Place these other items on your calendar. And if you're internet savvy, on our website, you will find all the photos from our parish picnic last week. And we had a great time in great weather. And you'll see your friends and neighbors on the internet on our website if you check that out later on in the day or during the week. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.